Hey, what's up? This is Sean from iZotope. I'm here with TW Walsh, mastering engineer extraordinaire, and we're going to talk about some mastering philosophy and also the fact that TW mastered my band Clap Your Hands, Say Yes record, Only Run, that came out last week. Do you think that you have a mastering philosophy?
I think that I started out with a mastering philosophy, which was really about retaining dynamics and not playing into the loudness wars. And in my own work, that's something that I adhere to. When I have total creative control, like, I really don't care about loudness at all for the most part. You know, it's more about the sound and the vibe. That's just a psychoacoustic thing. Like, louder sounds better.
It's going to get your attention. Right. Yeah. So what do you think of pre-mastering?
And now, what do you mean by pre-mastering?
By that I mean putting something on the mix bus and to create your two mix before you send it to somebody like yourself.
I'm all for making the mix sound exactly how you want it to sound. Like, the mastering engineer, you know, and when you're making a record, the job of the mastering engineer in my eyes is to make a uniform, like, cohesive sounding end result across the whole record. So I feel like you should make the mix sound exactly how you want. If you want to put a limiter on that and make it loud and then eliminate any headroom, it really handcuffs.
That's a problem.
Yeah, it really handcuffs the mastering engineer. But as long as you understand that you know, you're eliminating options down the road when you do that. If it's exactly how you want it to sound, then I say go for it. And the mastering engineer at that point, in a lot of cases, is just kind of saying, is giving their stamp of approval. Like, you know, they might be able to alert you to some kind of problems, like if there's clipping
or artifacts
or whatever. But a lot of times that's all you need from a mastering engineer is, like, quality control.
Mm-hmm.
So I would recommend not putting limiting on a master bus, but you know, use all the compression and EQ you want just to get it to sound exactly how you imagine it sounding.
How does mastering for vinyl differ from mastering for, say, CD and conversely, say, iTunes or SoundCloud or something like that?
Right. Okay. There's less of a concern about loudness on vinyl than there is in digital. So sometimes I'll do a vinyl master of a record that's actually got less limiting or maybe no limiting, so that I can retain more of the dynamics and more of the roundness of the sound. So loudness isn't as much of a concern. But also with vinyl, there's a couple other concerns. Like, the low end needs to be treated a little differently. Everything in the sub bass needs to be collapsed to mono, because the way that the needle oscillates from left to right, if the low end, since the wavelengths of low frequencies are so large, if it's too wide down there, the needle will jump out.
Right.
So you gotta treat the low end differently. Finally, like, the delivery format, you can deliver high resolution files to most, like, cutting houses. So you can deliver 24-bit, you can deliver, like, 96 kilohertz. And they also want, like, one file
as
per
opposed
side.
To 44.1.
Right, 16:44:1 is the standard format for CD, and actually for, like, standard iTunes and a lot of other digital delivery channels. So, like, with vinyl, you can deliver the high-resolution files, and then they also want the files in a different format. They just want one file per side as opposed to, like, one file per song.
Hmm.
So it's more of, like, a like, administrative task to, like, create a different delivery format than really doing. In a lot of cases, you don't end up doing that much differently except for those few key things, you know.
How much do you use mid-side compression?
I don't do much MS processing at all. The only time I'll do that is when I feel like maybe the vocals are too quiet, or the client has specifically asked me to address the vocal level, and I'll adjust the center channel volume in relative to the sides, or they say that, can you do anything about the kick drum, but we don't want to change how the synth bass sounds that's panned to left and right, I will EQ just the center channel. But it's kind of
it's like an mixing outlier. After mixing.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just not something that I do as a default, mm-hmm. but I'll do it to address like specific issues.
So do you use any, I think this is a similar question, but do you use any multi-band compression?
Okay. I'm not a fan of multi-band compression or mm-hmm. Or limiting. I find that for me, it's got kind of an artificial computer-y sound to it. And I'm more of a naturalistic, like meat and potatoes kind of guy. Like I'm a more of like a classic rock vintage sounding guy. And so I tend to like things that sound more natural.
So you think that multi-band sounds kind of dated in a way?
I don't think it's
as
not,
in like right now is
oh, right.
It's being used a lot. So like 10 years from now, people are going to be like, oh, they were using multiband there. And that's what they did at that time.
I guess that's one way to look at it. To me, it has a fake sound to it. Like mm-hmm. If I want to address a specific frequency, I will EQ it.
Yeah.
If there's dynamics issues, as far as like something poking out in a way, there's different ways you can do that. And like some of it is de-essing or high frequency limiting. Mm. A lot of times, like you're trying to address the high frequencies. And so there's like saturation, there's high frequency limiting, there's like tape processing.
There are other ways that don't change the sound.
Right, so for me, things start to get squishy and like the phase relationships of the different frequencies gets weird. And just to my ear, I don't like it. And so, I just don't use it just because I'm not comfortable with it. I feel like if I force myself to like really master it, I might find a way to use it in a way that I like, but I just haven't been forced to do that yet, you know. I like using kind of more simple tools.
Cool, man. I think we're done here.
Yeah, thank you.